This morning we are here again. We're on another part again, understanding the Reformation environment, pattern for personal spiritual application. It's a very technical environment. It's an environment that conscripts us of our pride. Reformation environment conscripts us of our pride. And after we subject to that conscription, it cleanses us and takes us from a level to another level. Reformation is about changing things to the pattern of God. It's about changing lifestyle, changing family patterns, changing the way we think, changing the way we talk, the way we behave. Because there are tendencies that when we reach a certain level of our lives, we become so complacent thinking that we've arrived and we are mature, it's okay. But as we keep moving from one journey to another, he always sends the spirit of reformation to say, hey, watch out. Things are dwindling. Things are not as supposed to be. You have to transcend. So this season comes about to restructure us, to mend what has been bent in our lives, and to organize us properly. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So today we're talking about Timothy, a very fantastic icon, complicated icon, an icon that if you're not careful, you will not capture where he is going, because he deals with a scattered strategy that helps the church to experience a forward march that brings glory to the King of Kings. Hallelujah. You have to understand him. He's a kind of technical guy. He tells you so much bits and pieces that galvanize our growth, that strengthen us, that make us what God wants us to be. So when the church started in the book of Acts, you have the Old Testament. After all of the setup of the Old Testament, Christ had to come, bringing this reformation, and he released onto the earth. This is how the new church is supposed to be. This is how they're not supposed to be. And he died, leaving behind profound instructions to the church. This is what you should do. This is what you should do. This is what you should do. And Paul, Silas, Peter, and other guys spread his messages all around us. This is what Christ believes. So for every time you are operating in a sphere and you subject yourself to the Holy Spirit, reformation will always come. Remember, the God of Israel, don't force his will on us. He suggests divinely to us. And this is the way. We talk on Friday as a way that seems right to all men, but the end is death, the end is destruction. Because we have this mindset that this way we are going is the best. And we're talking about the two roads, the narrow road and the wide road. The wide road, many are flocking into it, leading to destruction and bad way. And the narrow road has been discovered by the very few, leading to life. So this is why you experience a lot of good things took place in the book of Acts. Because the church was being started. And when the church is on the move, when God is laying his mark in the church, he tolerates nothing funny, because at that moment, the devil is set to corrupt what God is doing. So the kingdom of Christ was also on the throne. condemnation to us as a church. We should open up. Because when God is before me, let things take place. When he calls for order, he calls for judgment. When God says, I'm putting things in order, it means that he stand by to go against anyone that want to bring this order at a particular time. Yeah. So we should search ourselves. Because this is not something that happens upon you as a cloud that you receive moving. The cloud isn't moving anymore. It is the word that moving into us like a needle. We have to accept it and subject to the sovereignty of the King of Kings. Yeah, where we are. So all the funny gymnastic things that we honor, all the jingles, we got to set ourselves. Put on the set light in ourselves. Because it's time for reformation. We have to understand. Because it's a pattern for personal spiritual application. Don't allow anything to stand in your way. This is why when Paul was preaching one night in Acts chapter 20, a guy fell asleep and he fell from upstairs down and he died immediately. Now, when Reformation is going on, remember, the devil always wants to give an impression that what is going on is not correct. So they want to dishonor the church, disrupt the church. So you have to kill that guy. And Paul said, no, what is going on is not of God. It's of the devil. That's not coming out of that in our surrounding, in our spheres as believers, when things are going on, you should have a capacity to know whether it is of God or whether it is from the devil. Hallelujah. Because if you don't mind yourself, there are a lot of things you will suffer and say it is gospel, it will not be gospel. You have to imagine your capacity to understand, is this gospel? So Paul had to calm down and raise that guy. And the joy of the church continues with accuracy. They continue on the hinder. So there are things that will distract you. Remember, there are things that you have to surrender. So there's unusual instructions that are coming our way. They will come in an audible voice, they will come silently, they will come in any way. Sometimes they come very hard, sometimes the instructions are not so diplomatic, they are so hard. When the instructions are coming, when the revelation is coming, our opinion doesn't matter. What matters is the will of God. Church, it is the will of God that matters. So we have to surrender to him and accept reformation in our lives. To accept what God is doing. It's not about your objection. God is not concerned about our objection, our feelings. I think this is how we're supposed to be known. It's God's will. The will of God is the will of God. So the church starts to move. And in the midst of that, all guys were raised. And I told you about Timothy, how Timothy, I was wonderful icon. Set up these things, this teaching, these scattered teachings that you have not cared for, you go off balance. Timothy never had a mission. What went on in the book of Timothy was not a particular mission, fixed like all prophets. No, this was just scattered instructions, scattered instructions. It's like a military warfare. You say move, capture, kill, and destroy. So Timothy was spread out. Gave a scattering instruction of how the church should move. The expectation in mind of God, which is Christ, what Christ was saying to the church. So after we went through Timothy, we realized certain components. There was so specific in the season that we are in. So we have to discuss these issues that help us to capture what Timothy is saying, because we cannot get into all. It's a long and huge subject. But what we have the privilege to hold today, we make use of it. Because you cannot hold on to all of the resources of the kingdom. You'll be blown up in any time. Hallelujah. That's wrong. So for this reason, issues after we instead of going through what Timothy was actually saying to the church. What Timothy was saying to the church. Remember, don't forget, after the structure of the church, a lot of things are happening. We experience growth. We experience kingdom lifestyle. And now the guys came and said, look, it has to continue. So the major thing, one of the things that we got was a Christian character, a character that Timothy was stressing on that helped us to cooperate with the Reformation system that has been structured. So you need the kind of character as a Christian. You don't need a calling yourself a character. You need a character that will lead you or that will make you to be able to accept what God is saying. Because you know, sometimes people reject things based on their quality of character. Yes, people reject instructions because their character is not conforming with what is happening. You're telling somebody, say, when you transact this business, make sure you get the full receipt. The person not get the receipt because why? You know that it goes for cheat. So we got to conform with a particular character that the kingdom has called for, which qualifies us to be kingdom citizens. The Christian character, good character. There's a good old saying around that charisma will take you on top, but it takes character to keep you there, for it to be maintained. Our character is how we structure ourselves. To what Timothy is saying, Timothy says, character, you gotta accept, you gotta take me. Character is about dying. Character is about dying. Because whatsoever that is upon you, that you are overwhelmed with, the word of God is coming saying that God is not the way. Take the side. So you have to be willing to accept and die and flow in what God is saying concerning our lives. You have not your own saying. We subject to his rulership, to the king's rulership. There's character. He said this guy is obedient. There's character. Amen. So anywhere we find ourselves and does not conform with what God is saying, it's not a good character that has an attraction to work with in the kingdom. The kingdom has a lifestyle. The kingdom has a character that we need to work along with. That people are so concerned about titles. I told somebody, he said, but somebody told me that you did. Why can't you tell me that it is? I said, no, it's not about this. It's about what I can do. It's, what did you see in me? Then he said, oh, I see why you are behaving against this. I said, no, I'm not behaving against this because of the demon. I'm behaving against this because God wants you to behave against this. So if you see that way then, it means that those that will behave should be passive. Sorry. A revelation form. What a strange thing that you see in the building today. What a strange happen. Look around. Pastor Glancy. Come on, come on. The moment is going to the moment. Level up. Hallelujah. Church, our second thought is obedience. All Timothy was talking about. As I told you on Friday, insecurity, the first law is insecurity. Number one is obedience. Number two is obedience. Number three is obedience. This is why you see our national security, the state security, isn't striking, going on the rampage because they taught them obedience. But there are a lot of rotten things that are happening in our security sector that if you are close to any of them, they tell you you'll be so discouraged. But because of obedience, that's how the kingdom is. The kingdom calls for obedience. You don't have to obey because I'm talking to you diplomatically. You don't have to be obedient because the word of God is in your favor. You have to be obedient because this is God's will concerning you. your mind. God wants you to be obedient. Say, this is what the Bible said, but I think I will do it this way. Timothy was stressing. He's in this reformation time, in this environment, we are going to understand that one of the things that is matter, one of the things that is alarming, one of the things that is being talked about, that is raising red flag, is that obedience. Obedience. We find it so hard, so difficult. So Timothy said, the church will not triumph, the church will not work, and the church is celebrating disobedience, then you have a weak church to contend with. I got to go. I got to compete with you. I won't go on Sunday if we won't go with me. Hallelujah. Amen. It's for all of us. That's looking at the material, I ask myself, how obedient I am. Because I'm not molding. I am not molding what I'm teaching. What I'm teaching is more than me. So I ask myself, how obedient I am. Now I was telling Pastor Alex, you know, sometimes we need to share some things with you to know how far we're making sacrifices. You know, I have been tracking, as a security man, I've been tracking what has been going on in headquarters, Farmington, and a lot of security details, security information, external protection, close protection, VIP, you name all of them. And they gave an instruction, they said on Sunday, the road will be closed from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. This is how we're supposed to be as believers. Not to complain, but to be ahead of the world. So what I did, I strategized. 8 o'clock, I was at Pastor Eric's house. I slept there. So that law doesn't affect me. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Obedience. You can't say, oh, I want to come to church and go cross the road. This thing will always happen. The one of our great teachers in the world today, Dr. Noel Woodruff, said, in the midst of time, let's create time. Why is he saying there are so much congestion in the world today? So much congestion in the world. So much things are happening. They will be so alarming in a way that they won't get any time to bring. But you have to be strategic as a believer. You have to be wise. To always be ahead of the devil. Hallelujah. Amen. Don't think things will be how it used to be. There are times will come where anybody, the woman you want to say hallelujah, step out of the way. Pull your mouth. Are you getting what you're saying? Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Why is saying thank you? You're saying hallelujah in your heart. Stop. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Obedience in this time that we're in. Obedience is what matters. Instructions will be coming. You know when God is giving instruction like it has been given to our Father, we don't know what is coming next. So get ready. Get ready. We don't know what is coming next. You know, for us as pastors, when this instruction comes, we kind of be shaky a little bit because we don't know what God is about to say next. When he prepares the ground for us. But after he has instructed, there are other things he comes to tell you to do. And we have to conform. Church. So get ready, prepare your mind. And God look at you in your lucrative job. God is saying that leave, walk away from that job. In this reformation time, God is saying that the thing that you used to do, that you used to do, you find pleasure in doing, walk away from it. Last instructions to become. We have to obey. The Christian life is not a comfortable life. The next thing is to compete for the faith that we need. We have to compete. How many of us compete for our faith? How many of us compete for our faith? Competing for our faith, for the faith, the Christian faith. It's about getting hold of an eternal structure. Getting hold of an eternal manifestation. Because when you take hold of your faith, what it does, the reason for which you have been called, the reason for which your faith has been given to you, the reason for which Christ died, you allow yourself to experience a profound manifestation of those ingredients as Christian. You are not afraid, you are not ashamed to behave, to act, to declare, to operate as a Christian. You don't go to a Samoa bar on Friday. Then when you come into church on Sunday, you're afraid to hold a Bible because somebody saw you there. And it's a shame. It's a warfare, it's a struggle. It is Christ that will take you from there. But be bold enough to demonstrate those ingredients, those catalysts as Christian, that you're competing for your faith. You're telling the people on the other side that this is my faith. I don't care what. I promote it. I exhibit that lifestyle. But Timothy is telling us, in this environment of reformation, we have to compete. Don't get the wrong Muslims and refuse to pray and refuse to call anymore Jesus. You can demonstrate that Christ has given you. I told you on Friday about how do you call it, God? This rich guy, Bill Gates' wife, after an intensive interview, the pastor that was interviewing her, Pastor Una wanted for her to tell the world that I am doing what I'm doing because I'm a Christian. So the pastor journalistically tried to conscript out of that, just that statement, and she was clever enough, she couldn't utter to the world that I'm doing it because of Christ's sake. Yeah, the enemy starts saying my spirituality is personal. It's nothing personal. That's the word in America. When it comes to my spirituality, it's personal. It's not personal. Then you're not competing with your faith. You're hiding. You come up with something that means not to be covered. It's not personal. The world gotta know who you are. Hallelujah. The world gotta know. So when you're scared to call Jesus in someone, don't talk about it. Forget about the fault. The fault when it coming, and God will be brushing you gradually. Gradually working on us. The kingdom is about process. The kingdom is not an event. God takes his time to work on us. Oh yes. The news about Mary Magdalene, the prostitute, was still on. People were talking about her. But Jesus was still carrying on in his team. To be part of the team because she surrendered and cleansing was going on. Jesus not tell the wait, go fast and pray for 6 months before you start to follow us. Jesus had Jesus moving. Jesus took them along in their dirty clothes, their dirty mentality, their dirty lifestyle. So it's a process work. It's a progressive process work. It keeps going from one end to another till the glory of this. Hallelujah. Amen. But you see, the next thing is the God, the heritage of the faith in this our time. The heritage that has been given to you, Christ's heritage. So much that has been given to you, that has been entrusted into your hands. The kingdom resources. How this heritage, how to keep all of it. There's so much gifting, so much talent, so much resources. Speaking in tongues, praying. Yeah, some of you pray so much. Speaking the word. I mean, how can you manage these resources that will bring it up? All of our existence as Christians, all that we do is to bring glory to the King of Kings. It's not to make it for ourselves. Making it for ourselves is detrimental to our relationship with the King. It's only to bring glory to God. And this resources that God has given us, how are we guiding it? How are we working with it? How are we making it happen? Who are the people that are benefiting from this resource? That don't have the opportunity to get hold of it. That are being entrusted to you. What is your giftings? What is your talent? What do you have that the kingdom of God has released unto you? How well are you managing it? How well are you guiding it? say when I'm drinking, it can come to pass. But how many persons are you helping out in your dream? In a dream, giftings. Hallelujah. How many? I'm forgetting we have what we have by the grace of God. Hallelujah. Amen. That's wrong. We're talking about identifying with God openly. You know, a lot of us, we are full of evangelism. The reason why we are full of evangelism is for the fact that we look at our faults too much. Yeah, I'm talking about it. Hallelujah. Man, what person do? You have to be in a position to convince the person despite your guilt. When you start talking about God business, once upon a time, I was somewhere, somebody called me, Pastor, the woman said, he? They won't laugh. She chuckled. You fucking lady. When he became pastor? Obvious fact. And somebody came back to me and said, if he's a pastor now, good. But I was there when our bishop declared that God has called him. At that time, he was appointed. So if it's happening now, I believe it. Because this bishop is a man that will believe when he says something, God can back his word. I cannot talk like that to me. Because the place where people are calling for pastors, they were pastors that you see, you can see the external thing on them. In that area, people thought that the only way you're a pastor, unless you got to be having this external configuration with you, your coat. In fact, you can't wear slippers around, you gotta wear shoes around. Don't go wearing bathroom slippers around. We know how the quality of clothes to put on. But instead of calling, the excitement was there. But people try to degrade us because of that. And you know, so but I was not in there. I was intimidated strongly. But this is a woman baby. In fact, when a woman came across me, the first sermon she ever heard from me, she condemned the sermon.
Hallelujah. Amen.
But say here we are today, years back, one time she called me for the stage. He said, are you still a pastor? I said, by his grace, sir. So God be the glory. She said, I had wonderful things about you. Keep it up. I did not shun away. I openly will get out there. Encourage people, that's how it's supposed to be. You may not go to somebody and start to quote scriptures like a powerful evangelist, but there are things that we do that gave us what we call open identification of the God that we serve. The things that we say, the way that we interact, we transact with people. We identify with God with our hearts. We identify with God with our love, our resources. There are so many ways that we identify with God. That brings glory to God. Everything around us got to speak for God. Everything around us openly identifying. What people are saying, these are the structures, these are the makeup, the statues that came in the church, that made Christ to be what he's supposed to be, that brings glory to God. In terms of reformation, we've got to open up. When you're moving, you don't hide, don't put on good and say no. I will talk about Jesus in the house when we go. But not now, when we're in a different place, we're in. Somebody said, in this house of parliament, don't call me pastor, not pastor anymore. Failing to identify with God openly. The day they won't vote me again, then you can't call me pastor. Because of what is around us, you can't allow those things to bring you down. Hallelujah. Amen. Be strong in the grace. Church. Strong in the grace. We talk about recipient of the grace on Friday. We talk about dispensing the grace. You have to be strong in the grace. The grace is a resource. You receive the grace. You dispense the grace. Lord, grant me grace. And at the same time, I talk about kindness. I said kindness can be paid, but it can be extended. So when God, we receive the grace of God, and we dispense the grace of God. Because the grace of God is not given to us to hold it and be Lord over it. It's to share. In every form, in every shape, in every manner. So what Timothy was teaching us, teaching the church, these are the pillars that make the church to be what it's supposed to be. So you have to understand what Christ came and died for. God did not come to die because of some fashion show or some historical map that has been set somewhere. Christ came to die to change lifestyle, to change the minds of people, to change their own way of thinking, because in the world, everything was about the flesh. Now he's saying this time around it should be about the spirit. Internal configuration of our lifestyle. Restructure. So we gotta dispense grace as we become recipient of grace. Difficult times ahead. Our faith in Christ must be, should be immovable in order to exploit, to do exploit in the kingdom.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
The challenges coming our way. In this movement, there are challenges. Or will that be where and not? Not possible. Or will that be where and not? One time somebody said to our father, he prophesied on somebody that you will get a car. And in a short time, the person got a car. Meanwhile, that time he got a car. Then he was with me. Everything you prophesied, the way you get the car, you get the car, you get the car. These are challenges. But in a short future, he got a car. All will not be well. The difficult times affect our families. We gotta be strong. The difficult times affect our businesses. We gotta be strong. The difficult times affect our businesses, our finances, our education, everything that we plan to do. When the difficult times come, the devil comes and sown into your family, thinking that you are for Christ, he will cause destruction. These are difficult times. They're bound to come. They will come. All will not be in Rosalind. They will come. Sometimes it affects our children. They say you are strong, a Christian, but your children are all in war. You gotta fight that other war. There are some people, they are struggling for children, don't have children. That's a difficult time. Some people struggling to get married. Some people struggling to raise their children. Some people struggling to get jobs. Some people different kinds of things happen to us. They have difficult times in the midst of this reformation. Difficult times are with us. Remember! Remember! It's not bread and butter in the kingdom. But you will always be there. You promise us to be there. Like a story that I heard about somebody who was talked to him about Christ. And he was taught about Christ, and he got so overwhelmed about Christ. And he came on time, this difficult time descended upon his life. Then he started to complain. He went to the beach. He started to complain. They say, you Christ, you died for me. And this is what I'm going through. I cannot see you. How? What the pastor said about you? What my friends Christian told me about you? What the Bible said about you? I cannot see you. He was so rage. He talked. When he kept silent, then he heard the voice that said, yes, I'm there with you. He said, how can you prove that you're there with me? I'm walking, and when I look behind me, two-step, a foot, behind me. Then Jesus said, yes, there were two. The two he saw, it was me. Then he asked, where I was? Jesus said, I have you in my hands.
Hallelujah.
Amen. So you go through the storms with us. You think when you're going through no peace, he's not, he's with you. I don't care how terrible it is, Christ is always with us. This is one of the blessed assurance that we are celebrating. When we grieve, he grieves. When we are happy, he's happy. Everything that we go through, he don't celebrate with us. He go through the pain, the anguish, the agony with us. Holding us, crying with us. There's some more. a great strong Christian. Or the Lord died. Or only daughter. She was crying. She cried so much. She was crying, crying, crying. She cried, cried, cried. She lacked it. No, she cried, cried, cried until she got caught up in a vision. Then she saw Christ. Christ was crying. Crying. Then she saw. He said, oh, Christ crying. Christ, why are you crying? He said, I'm crying because you're crying.
Overwhelming evidence of our Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Gotta be informed. Let's go. Let's go. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Understanding. Reformation of empowerment. Pattern for question of spiritual application. The core values of the scripture. There are many of them. Many of them. And I trust that as we go home, we read through Timothy and get a lot of things. Don't be distracted. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Number one, love from a pure heart. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You know, I always say love is an action word. Love. Let me tell you, sometimes people, when you say this, people get offended. Love is not complete in the absence of giving. Love is never complete in the absence of giving. Love is an action word. So how it becomes pure? There are catalysts of love that makes it pure. Giving is one of them. Forgiveness is one of them. Sacrifice is one of them. Amen. Prayer is one of them. By praying for somebody, that's giving. You give your spiritual life for somebody. You sit down and pray for them. So let me pray for the brother. Let me pray for the pastor. That's a woman who's on the top of the table. Pastor, I pray that all of your physical needs be met. I'm here, but the fact that she always says this to me, I always succumb to that word. That she's giving me, it's a spiritual comfort of her life that she's sharing with me, praying with me. Pure love. This is why in the book of Acts, when we go back to the book of Acts, the Bible says nothing they owned was credited to somebody. If Chris gets something, it's for the whole church. If Pastor Nubo gets something, it's for the whole church. Nothing was owned that was credited to somebody. That's the pure love that he demonstrated. It was his own brother. You can remember one time somebody paid for our food here? Nobody asked him who did it. The person high. Nobody put the person. I just said leave, but somebody paid. Yeah. You see the money that I have, I think everybody got to eat some of this food. Pure love attracts respect. If you love somebody, you got to respect them. That's why in the midst of all of the characters that Christ was dealing with, Christ, you know that Christ respected his apostles so much. The disciples, he respected them. He respected them so much, they changed his thoughts. He said things to them, and they replied. They had this transaction. He respected them. When you look at the quality of Christ and Peter and other guys, they're unmatchable. They didn't fit. Somebody can say much less. But Christ respected them because he loved them. That's why he decided to wash their feet as a high sense of humility and respect and value for his disciples. Hallelujah. Targeted group. Who's standing at the base of the scripture? Who the scripture is talking to? Is it for the bishop? Is it for the pastors? Who God is talking to? Who he came from? Who he came to die for? We are the ones. We got to get hold of this and make it ours. Our property. This is mine. There are people that say, no. There are people that stand in the way. Somebody was concerned about the kind of quality of people that got around him. He said, look, I've not come for the excellent lifestyle. I come for those with broken and shattered life. That's why he turned around and said, I don't come for those that are ill already. What Christ was alluding to was that in our mind, we feel that the word of God is not for me. It's for a certain class of people. So Christ was saying, those that accept the word are the ones that come to. Because that's the targeted group. We take it, this is fine. Don't be like the guy who talked on Friday, the same group. When Pastor said, oh, I know this thing, I know it already, man. I know it. We've got to accept what the Bible is saying. And hold it as your, this is mine. Christ is talking to me. This is mine. We are on the firing line. We've got to accept that. Amen. Is that a conscious warning? Conscious warning is talking about after he warns how much we value what he said. How much we place value on that. Because you know, when you read the Bible, when the Bible talks to us, he's expecting a response. Christ is expecting a response. God just speak and leave it open. You read the Bible, classic conversation, responses. He's concerned about response. But one time after he has invested so much in his disciples, he asked them, who do men say I am? They have to respond. Who do you say I am? Men and you. Looking at the proximity. What they are saying, they are far off. But what are you saying? You close to me. No. What are you saying? And they responded. Amen. So how much the value of placing what God is saying? Do we expect a testimony after the season shall pass of reformation? Do we expect people to be brave to say, after this season that was pronounced by Bishop Capet, this is what God has been doing? Yes. So you laugh. You say, Bishop?
Yeah.
Yeah. I just want to tell you. Look in the red, you check it out. Hallelujah. Church, are you willing to identify with him openly by coming to give testimony? I've been blessed by the Reformation season. This is what God is doing, my family. This is what God is doing. That's the response the church is expecting. Christ is sitting waiting for us as we go through. Hallelujah. We detest godliness. You see, our behavior after this thing must change. Profound display. Look how God is asking us to change now. The things I used to do, I do them no more. The things I used to say, I say them no more. The way I used to walk. Yes. It's a great change that we're expecting. Christ is expecting. Great change that we expect in church. When God speaks, there's an expectation. When Christ speaks, there's a response. He says, say those things that are not as if they were, that have Christ operating. Christ don't want you to change before you start to speak. You know when you speak, you will change. He expects you to conform. Reformation time. Then allow yourself to be distracted. Amen.
Amen.
Being an example. Church. Example in our conduct. Be an example in our conduct. Scripture is telling us to be an example. be an example. You know, one of the dangerous times about Christianity is when you're in the face of people. People are watching you. The way you conduct yourself, people are watching you. People start to detest your quality. People start to detest on your behavior. The way you go spiritual things with a pinch of salt, people look at you. Bishop Kappa always say, don't assign people. Give me a chance. Don't assign people to responsibility. You should come out, you should have that sense of belonging, that willingness, that leadership. Amen.
Amen.
You have that. That is, you come as an example. Your whole life is an example. I have to convince myself why sometimes when I pray, I don't close my eyes. Watch me. Why everybody close your eyes? Why you close your eyes? I will take time to explain why I don't close my eyes. It's not, I will be forced to close my eyes because you have been trained to always close my eyes. So be an example. If you think you will not be prosecuted, watch for your children. Yes, if you think you will not be prosecuted, watch for your children. You've got to watch those things that you're doing. The moment you storm, your children come and correct you. Man, this is what you say. Bad, this is what you say. So we have to be an example.
Yeah.
Wrong. Thank you.